All right, good evening, good evening, good evening, everybody. Hey, this is the night that the Lord have made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. Good evening to you, every one of you, and thank y'all so much for tuning in to our online Kingdom Life Bible study tonight. Listen, tonight's going to be a fantastic, we'll have fantastic time in the Lord.
Yes, we are.
And I really believe God's going to do something supernatural, something amazing tonight. Mm-hmm. So what we need y'all to do, we need y'all to call a friend, text a friend, tweet somebody, Facebook somebody, do something on Instagram, Facebook Live, do something. Like,
do something.
Share, tag, invite, start a watch party today. Man, it's going to be lit. It's going to be fire tonight. So we just need you to get with us tonight. So again, y'all share, like, tag, invite, start a watch party tonight. We get ready to worship God tonight. Matter of fact, we're going to praise him tonight.
Oh, yes,
we're
going to
praise him tonight. So y'all come on and get with us and let's praise tonight. If he did it before, he'll do it again. We believe that. Come on, y'all. Come on in tonight. Let's worship him.
Please go ahead, share, tag, like, invite, start a watch party while we're worshiping God tonight.
Yes. Come on, y'all. Share, like, tag, and invite tonight. Listen, we don't own the rights to this music.
That's right.
But man, we're using it tonight to praise God. We just believe if he did it before, he'll do it again.
He will do it again.
Again, we don't own the rights to this music, but we're using it to praise him tonight. So y'all share tonight, y'all like, y'all tag, y'all invite. It's going to be amazing tonight, I promise you.
All right, let's see what we got on tonight. Good evening, Captain Price. Thank you for joining us.
Hey, Auntie.
Hello, Bambi. Thanks for joining us on tonight. Hello, my sister Kelly Johnson is on. Hello, Sheila Roby. Hello, Catherine Price again. V-Lo Wright is on tonight.
V-Lo is the bomb.
Sharonda Powell, hello. Thanks for joining us on tonight. Again, please share, tag, like, invite, start a watch party, invite some of your family members and your friends.
Yeah, please do that tonight. Hey, shout out to Marlena Ferguson Clark, who's on tonight. But we need y'all to share. We need y'all to like. We need y'all to tag. We need y'all to invite. Shout out to Minister Kim Simmons, who's on tonight as well.
Hello, Minister Kim.
Sing God right there.
If he did it before, he will do it again. Yes.
You're the spirit designer.
Oh, yes. If he did it before, he will do it again.
Yeah. Need y'all to share. We need y'all to like. We need y'all to tag. We need y'all to invite. Start a watch party tonight. Get other people to come on and be a part. Tonight's going to be awesome. Magnificent.
Oh, yes.
Yes, it is.
Oh,
listen,
yes.
We get ready to get some announcements tonight. But I need y'all to keep it in mind, if he did it before, he'll do it again. He'll do it again. Listen, y'all come on, share, like, tag, and invite. You know, we like to get some music going before we do Bible study or even our Sunday morning services.
That's
so
right.
Listen, I need y'all to stay on tonight, be a part. Don't let the enemy stop you from being on this service tonight. But listen, God's going to do something extremely amazing tonight.
Oh, yes.
And, man, we really believe that. We sincerely believe that. So I need y'all to release your faith with us tonight. and believe God for some supernatural things tonight, all right?
Oh, yeah.
So, hey, we're going to get these announcements.
That's right.
And then we're going to teach this word tonight.
Okay, well, of course, you know, we're in the month of October, and this is the month of Domestic Violence Awareness Month. So on October the 25th, we will be wearing our purple in honor of those who have lost a loved one or who have been experiencing domestic violence.
Yeah.
And domestic violence, I just want you to know that it has been impacted. It has impacted so many people during this time, during the pandemic.
Yeah.
And over millions of people each year, actually. So if you know someone or you have a family that's experiencing domestic violence, you can give them this hotline number, which is 800-799-SAFE.
Mm-hmm.
Again, that number is 800-799-SAFE. Also, if they would like to not call them and they want to give a message to them so they can reach out to them, they can also go by online, which is www.thehotline.org. Again, that's www.thehotline.org. And okay, keep in mind, you guys have been on Overseer Vet in the backyard Monday through Friday. I'm telling you, if you did not tune in this morning, you missed out. I'm telling you, it was a dynamic word about open door. I'm telling you, if you did not see it, go back and watch it. So keep in mind, that's every morning, Monday through Friday at 8:15 a.m. And then we have our Impact Giving that's coming up. I am so excited.
Yeah, me too.
This is a time when me and my husband, we started out by leading with $1,000.
Yeah.
And this is to actually help us in ministry, help us with the vision that God has given him. And I'm excited to what God is going to do on that particular day. Because
yeah,
it seems like every time we have Impact Giving, miracles happen.
Yeah, they do. They do.
Yes.
So I'm excited about it, too.
Yes.
I'm excited about it. We got our prepared. We ready to go.
Yes, we are ready to go. And then keep in mind, whatever city you're from tonight, just put at the bottom what city. We would love to know where you're tuning in from tonight as well.
Yeah, please do that.
Please do that.
Yeah.
Yes. Please
do that. Do that right now. Put in what city you're from
What city are you tuning in from?
Yeah, please do that.
Yes.
We want to make sure we give you a shout out for that.
That's right. And then also, I see that my brother is on. Timothy Price is on.
Hey, brother. What's up, man?
Yes. Hello.
Hey, my sisters are back there too, man. Shout out to my sisters.
Hello, my sisters.
Shout out to my sisters who are back there.
We love you guys and we miss you guys. I can't wait to get back to Mississippi and be with the family again. It was just so amazing. I mean, true love, just true love, I'm telling you. And then also keep in mind, if you would like to join us on Monday through Friday, we have our prayer conference call, and that's on Monday through Friday at 6:30 a.m. If you'd like to join us, that number is 302-202-1117. Again, that number is 302-202-1117. And we have an access code, and that access code is 534-283. Keep in mind, we are still in the pandemic, so we are definitely praying for those who are experiencing any kind of sickness and illness. We are also praying for those who are on the front line, those who are essential workers that are going out every day and working tirelessly to serve us. We want to say we thank you and we appreciate you.
Yeah.
And we are definitely praying for you. If anyone need prayer tonight after the service, we'll be praying for you guys at the number, which is 323-238-9915. Again, that number is 323-238-9915. And again, that's immediately after our Bible study on tonight. We'll be praying for anyone who needs prayer. And that is it.
All right. Hey, we're streaming tonight on our Facebook page.
Yes,
we're
also
streaming from our church's Facebook page, Kingdom Life Faith Center. They're saying it's cracking a little bit on that page. So listen, you can go to the Pastor Perryman page, Overseer Curtis Perryman page, and get on there from there. But we're streaming on Instagram tonight, and we're also live via conference call tonight.
Yes, we are.
So thank y'all so much for tuning in tonight. We appreciate you. But listen, we need you to give us a big shout out as to what city you in. We saw
Greenwood,
Mississippi. We saw Brandon, Mississippi.
Yes, we got some
That's
LA folks.
Tonight. We got some LA people on here. Listen, my mother, Dorothy Perryman Brewer, is on tonight. So
yes,
shout out to my
Long
mom tonight, who's on. Shout out to her. Love you, mom.
Yes.
Listen, Cleveland, Ohio is in the house.
Yes, we have Cleveland,
and
Ohio.
And my auntie had the nerve to put Cleveland Browns.
Germantown, Maryland.
My auntie needs prayer right now. Sheila Robin, you can see she put the Cleveland Browns on there.
Okay.
My auntie's a diehard Cleveland Brown fan.
I'm praying for you, auntie.
Oh, my goodness.
That's funny.
Let's get to it.
Yes, thanks for joining us.
Get your Bibles and lift it up high before the Lord. Let's make our confession of faith. Look, you know what's worse than that?
What?
My brother Timothy Price.
Yes.
He's a Denver Bronco fan.
No way.
Terrible, just like my daughter Treasure.
Oh, really? Oh, my daughter Treasure loves the Denver Broncos.
They can't wear for losing. Take your Bibles and lift it up high before the Lord.
Yes.
Let's make our confession of faith tonight. I need y'all to share, like, tag, invite. Need you to start a watch party tonight.
Yes,
all right?
We do. Yes, we
hey,
do.
Hey, Crystal in H-Town.
Hey, tonight, Crystal.
My daughter Jackie Hankins is on. My daughter Bam is on tonight.
Hello.
Love y'all. So let's share, let's like, let's tag, invite, right? Say it with me. Say, this is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
It is the Word of God.
It is the Word of God.
Inside of my
Inside
Bible.
Inside my Bible.
There's 66
books.
Of Revelation.
Of Revelation.
Insights.
Insights.
Concepts.
Ideas.
Blessings.
And instructions.
For my life.
For my life.
So tonight, I'll be taught the Word.
I'll hear the Word.
And I'll receive the Word.
And my life
will never be the
same.
In Jesus' name. All right. Hey, Frank. Good to see you, man.
Hey, Frank. Hello, family.
Okay, as you know, we've been in this teaching series where we've really been talking about kingdom impact giving. Kingdom
yes.
impact giving. And we talked about our kingdom impact makes a mark in the lives of people that can never be erased.
That's right.
But we talked about that our giving now is not to enrich a pastor, but it is to build for
is.
God. It's to encourage people. It's to motivate people.
Right.
It's to pull people up out of the muck and the miry clay. It's to give people who God really is.
Yeah.
And in order for us to do that, we need resources to do it.
That's
it takes
right.
resources to do it. So that's the reason that we're doing our kingdom giving campaign. The
yes.
kingdom giving campaign is not to put money in our pockets,
not
but
at all.
It is to transform our ministry to such a way that we can bring a product to you
yes.
that can change lives all over the world.
Oh, yeah.
You understand? And so we've been using Exodus chapter 25, verse number 1 as a foundation. Well, Exodus chapter 25, our foundational text is what we've been using.
Mm-hmm.
And from Exodus 25, we see where God speaks to Moses in Exodus chapter 25, and he says to
right.
him, here's what I want you to do, Moses. I want you to speak to the children of Israel that they bring me an offering. And he says to them, I want you to take the offering from those people who would give it to me willingly. With their heart.
Yes.
So in a sense now, God is not into receiving an offering from somebody who doesn't want to give it.
Exactly.
So that's why we don't put pressure on you to give, because
no, we
if we
don't.
Put pressure on you to give, then you're giving because we pressured you mm-hmm. and not because you wanted to do it.
Right.
So God now is saying to Moses, receive an offering, or take an offering from those people who would give it willingly.
Mm-hmm.
And then he tells him exactly what offering to take. So now if you look at Exodus chapter 25, and you start looking at verse number 8, you will see that it is scripture for God to name the offering type that he wants from the people. So verse number 8 says it like this. Exodus 25, verse number 8. Not verse 8, but let's look at verse number 4.
Okay.
Well, verse 3 is where he says and this is the offering which you shall take of them, gold and silver and brass and blue and purple and scarlet and fine linen and goat's hair and ram skin dyed red and badger skin and shittim wood, oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil, for sweet incense, onyx stones, and stones to be set in the ephod and in the breastplate. And then he said, this is the reason for the offering.
Right.
And let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among my people. When you look at it, when he makes a point of a sanctuary, he's talking about a holy place, a sacred place where he can come and fellowship and meet with us.
Yes.
But now we understand that the Bible tells us that God does not dwell in temples made with hands. So in a sense, the building itself is not God's dwelling place. The scripture says we are.
Right.
So in a sense now, when you sow your seed and give sacrificially to the kingdom of God, a gift to your local church, you are helping us to build sanctuaries for God
yes.
to inhabit or for God to dwell. What's the sanctuary? It's people.
Yes.
We are touching the lives of people. Our mission and mandate that God gave us was to build people for next level living. And this is what God told me. He says, I'm going to uproot people from different churches and bring them to you so you can teach them my word.
That's right.
So that means now that every person who basically comes to become a part of the church that I pastor
yes.
is a people who already been in church but probably have not heard the word on a kingdom level.
Right.
So God brings them to me for me to teach them his word. And in the process, we build them up for next level living.
Right.
He told me that there are people who have reached a point in life But they're wondering, is there anything else beyond where I am? These people have become stagnant. These people became frustrated and irritated and agitated because church has just become monotonous for them. It's a religious thing that they do consistently, but there is no growth. There's no increase for them. And so he tells me that every person who comes to church is not always sick. So he says the church is not always a hospital.
That is so
but
true.
The church is a ready room for people to grab information so that they can know who he is and go out and reproduce what they just heard.
That's good.
And so that's our kingdom assignment. In order for us to do this, we have to make sure that we produce a product and release a product that will encourage people to come and be a part. We understand that we live in a technological age.
Oh, yeah, so we got to be more innovative.
Listen to this, people of God. For those of you who are much older saints,
yes,
you're looking for the building. The church is not going back to the way that it used to
not
be.
Not at all.
We will eventually go back into the building,
yes,
but guess what? Church will not be the same again.
It will not be the same.
Be technologically like never before.
That's right.
It's so important for you to understand it. The NBA showed us what technology could do to
reach people.
When they had the bubble and there was nobody in the stands.
Woo.
But guess what they did? They had it set up where you could see people from Zoom
all over the world. All over the world.
This is where we are today. Mm-hmm. And what God is doing is opening up a portal for us to reach people like never before.
Oh, yeah.
See, when you were in your building, you couldn't reach a person in Belize.
That's right.
You couldn't reach a person in Brandon, Mississippi. You couldn't reach a person in New York. You couldn't reach a person in Cleveland because we were shut up in our building.
Right.
Now God is expanding. I'm talking to somebody today.
Oh, yes.
He's expanding.
Yes,
he's expanding our capacity to receive by expanding our capacity to believe. This is so important. So this is why resources are needed in the kingdom.
That's why
your tithe is needed.
It is not
to enrich the pastor.
Let me get this.
I need you to understand this. This is not about the pastor. This is what God wants to do for you.
Yes.
I wonder how many people have been reached since the doors have not been fully open.
Wow.
What about the
mother?
How many people? What about the older mother who's in her 70s and really can't get up and go to church the way she wants to? She wants to be in church, love God, but she can't get it the way she wants.
Yeah.
Now she can see her pastor in the comforts of her own home.
Yeah, right on Instagram and
you understand?
Facebook.
She can see her pastor, get encouraged, get motivated, get the word. All of that comes by way of technology, but we need resources to get it done.
That's true.
Now, let's continue on now. We kind of left off with this last time. We talked about in the giving, and we said, in the giving, we said, now, whatever I give myself to gives back to me. This is a kingdom principle that God has established in the earth.
Oh, yeah.
Whatever I give myself to gives back to me.
Yeah.
That's something you ought to write down. Whatever you give yourself to gives back to you. All right. Luke 6:38 says it like this: give and it shall be given unto you. Notice what it says. Give and it shall be given unto you. So whatever I give myself to gives back to me.
It is
a kingdom principle that God has established in the earth. It is not man. God established this.
Man.
So it says give and it shall be given unto you. This is what he said how it's going to come back to us. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. So God is not interested in giving back to you what you gave him. What he wants to give back to you is on a pressed down, shaken together, and running over measure.
Yeah.
Because if God just gave back to me what I gave him, that means God is repaying alone.
Right. He wants to give you the overflow.
He wants us to live in the overflow. This is important now. So he gives back to us good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over.
Yes.
See, listen. The running over is not just for me to live off of, but it's for me to pour back into the kingdom.
Yes.
I got some people on here that's from the hood.
Yes.
Let me take you to the drug culture. When I was out there selling drugs and stuff, you understand? You start out buying a little half ounce don't make no money for you. You understand? You buy a little half ounce. You do what you gotta do. All you're doing is making enough money back, and maybe about $10-$20 over where you can just be able to put in about a couple of days, a couple of weeks, you might be able to graduate to an ounce. You're still not making no money. You understand? Because the money ain't in that. You're just doing a little bit. So now you got to graduate from the ounce to now you all of a sudden you're going to the quarter pound. You're starting to make a couple hundred dollars over, but you ain't really making no money.
Mm-hmm.
So now you got to graduate from that and you got to start dealing with half a pounds and pounds to the point now you can make some money. But notice this now, it cannot come back to me until I pour into it.
Exactly, exactly.
So watch now. So I don't make money if I'm just doing it on a small scale.
Mm-hmm.
But I make money now when it comes back to me on a press down, shaking together, running over measure level, because I'm doing it on another phase, another level. It's so important for us to understand this. This is a kingdom principle that God has established in the earth. So he says, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, press down, shaking together, and running over. And then he says, this is how it's coming back to you. Shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that you meet with all, it shall be measured back to you again. So notice this now. God is not raining money out of the sky.
Not at all.
It's not his principle. How does God bring it back to me? He brings it back to me through men.
Right.
Okay. This is why when you are a giver, you have to command your daily bread.
Yes.
You're commanding your daily bread to come, but not only are you commanding your daily bread to come, what you're doing is putting emphasis on the amount of daily bread you need.
Oh, yeah. Because everybody's daily bread is different.
Everybody's daily bread is different.
You might not need $1,000 a day. You might not need $50,000 a day.
Yeah, everybody's daily bread is different.
Everybody's daily bread
is
different.
So watch this now. You have to command your daily bread to come.
That's
only you know what your daily bread is. So you have to start commanding. So watch this now. My daily bread comes through the hands of people.
Right.
So watch now, because I'm a giver, I command my daily bread to come, but I'm also commanding people to be loose to bring me my daily bread.
Woo!
I'm talking to somebody. I had to learn
you
this principle.
You said be loosed. Yeah. Be loosed.
I learned this principle
That's
now
good.
From my pastor. I went to his house and took a seed over there one day because I've been a challenge about a year and a half ago.
Right.
I'm going through a challenge and took a seed over to him. He said, son, I'm going to need you to command your daily bread.
Command your daily bread.
Is what I have to do. I command my daily bread. He said, I have my family to look out for. I got my daughter and her family to look out for. He says, and I got the church. I have to command my daily bread to come to me.
That's right.
And he says to me, I command people to be loose to bring it to me.
Woo! That's good.
I walked
That's
away
good.
From there with my head held high, knowing that my seed worked.
Yes.
But at the same time, knowing that I just received answer to my prayer. See, sometimes when you plant a seed, you get back more than what you expected. It comes back on the press down, shaking together, and running over measure level. There are people today, because you don't command your daily bread, you don't even know when your harvest shows up. So you have to command your daily bread and command those people to be loose to bring it to your life. Because here's what God does. Because it's in the hands of people to give to you. God is the one who gave them the money. God also speaks to them.
That's right.
About giving you the seed, but giving you the harvest. Mm-hmm. But here's what people will do. Sometimes dismiss what God said.
Woo. That's disobedience, isn't it?
Yeah, sometimes people don't understand.
Wow.
So they'll dismiss what God said. Here, God. Here you are, you in need of $10,000, and you done sold your seed. You believe in God for $10,000.
Uh-huh.
So here's what God does, speaks to somebody and tells that person that, hey, I need you to go, I need you to take, I need you to send $10,000 to Captain Price. I need you to send it now.
Uh-huh.
And that person like, the devil is a lie. I'm not doing that. And so watch this now. They know it's God. First they go through the process and they start asking questions like this. God, is that you?
Is that
the devil or is that me? I can help you eliminate that right now.
Oh, yeah.
I can help you eliminate
it.
First of all, it can't be the devil because the devil will never tell you to do good in somebody's life.
That's right.
So you can't be the devil.
Right.
Now, he's out the picture.
Right.
Let me help you again. It ain't you because you didn't want to do it.
Woo.
So you eliminate it. That
you
means
eliminate.
One person in
one
the group
person.
Who told you to do it. It is God. So watch what happens. So people now get the well, God want me to do it, but I'll do it tomorrow.
Whoa.
I'll come next week. They know. And then when you finally talk to them, they'll say things like this. You know, God told me to give you this money, but I was just late. I figured I'd get there later. I'll come through another time.
Mm-mm-mm.
So watch. This is why you have to pray people free.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
To get, because God puts it in their hands. So every morning I command my daily bread and I command people to be loose to give to me.
Yes.
I command them to be loose. I'm telling you, it is so important that you do that. You don't just sow seed for nothing.
Right.
Let me go a step further than this before we move on with the lesson. I never forget. See, this is how you have to name your seed. I never forget my granddaddy behind our house on Al Turner Circuit. He had somebody come and plow some rows in the back of our house.
Okay.
You understand? We was going to have, you know, I remember him talking to my grandma at the table. We're going to have some corn back there. And he was saying we're going to have some okra back there.
Ooh.
He was naming out the stuff that was going to be in them
good.
Rows back there, right?
Uh-huh.
And I'm sitting there, I'm a little kid, I'm listening, but I don't know what they're talking about really. And granddaddy said, okay, we're gonna go to Greenwood tomorrow, we're gonna get it.
Okay.
If you know anything about Itabena, there ain't no shopping places over there to buy this stuff. So you gotta go from Itabena, was about a good 15-20 minutes, drive to Greenwood, and that was a seed store over there.
Oh,
a big one.
Okay.
And we walking in there, and grandmama's grabbing these little packages. And I'm saying, grandmama said, we gonna get corn. She grabbed these little packages. We gonna get some more. She grabbed a little package. And I'm sitting up here like, we get in the car, we headed back home now. I see you done a shot. I said, grandma, what? I thought you said we were getting corn and stuff. She said, I got it. And you know, I'm used to seeing the corn on the, you know, we done been to Piggly Wiggly. I see the corn inside the thing with the husk on and everything. I don't see that.
Wow.
So I'm like, grandma, we didn't get no corn and no okra and stuff like that. She said, we did. I got it. It's in the car. I don't see that.
You don't see.
And then this is what she did. She took the package out of the bag and shook it. This is it. I was like, there is no way in the world
that little seeds is corn.
There can't be.
Uh-huh, little seeds.
But watch this now. When I looked closely at the package, mm-hmm. it had a picture.
Yes.
And a name of what was on the package.
Right.
So in a sense now, the name that is on the package that tells us what's inside of the package.
Oh, yeah.
What's inside of the package will become what I saw on the picture.
Oh,
it had to be planted. I'm talking to somebody today. So you have to name your seed. Name your seed. You don't just sow seed haphazardly. You name your seed. You target your seed.
Oh, yes.
Your seed has a destination.
That's
you don't
right.
just give just to be giving. I give with a target in mind.
Oh, yes.
I give with a destination in mind. I'm not just giving, but I'm targeting my giving.
Yes.
Because every seed produces out its own kind. If you don't name the seed cannot come back to you on the level that you needed to come back in. So I must command my daily bread. I command people to be loose to give to me.
Oh, yes.
But when I do that, and I'm sowing my seed, I name my seed.
Name your seed.
You got to name your seed. Mm-hmm. You got to name it. It's important. You must name your seed.
Yes.
Let me continue on with this now. We left a little bit off of this. We said, when I'm a giver, God alters the course of my life. When I'm a giver, God aligns me with the right people that can help me. And when I'm a giver, God positions me to receive answered prayer.
Mm-hmm.
So when I'm a giver now, here's what God does. He alters the course of my life.
Right.
In other words, God will cause me to turn and go in a direction that he wants me to go into
right.
by way of a supernatural encounter or a sovereign encounter.
Mm-hmm.
See, watch now. When I'm a giver, God obligates himself to make sure I go in the right direction that I may bump into my destiny.
Oh,
so
yeah.
When you look at Genesis chapter 26, the Bible said there was a famine in the land. And the Bible said the famine was in the land that was bigger than the famine that was in Abraham's day. Isaac now is the son of Abraham, and it's amazing how he is repeating the same thing that his daddy went through.
Mm-hmm.
And so now he's about to try and escape a famine and go down to the land of Egypt. And here's what God does. Alters the course of his life.
Oh, yeah.
And has him go into Egypt. He tells him, go not down into Egypt, but dwell in the land that I tell you of. Dwell in the land of Gear. And the Bible says he sowed his seed in that land. And the Bible said, and in that same year, he received 100-fold. And the Lord blessed him. Watch now. If God didn't intervene in his life and alter the course of his life, he would have went somewhere else and missed his breakthrough.
That is so true.
So God alters the course of my life, but here's what God will also do. He'll align me with the right people that can help me.
Oh, yes.
In other words, he'll connect me with people who will bless my life.
Yeah, he said he'll raise up somebody somewhere to use their powers, to use their ability, and to use their resources.
To help me.
Yeah.
I like how Apostle Ivy Hilliard says.
Yes.
He says, God is obligated to bring me in the company of the people that I need to know.
That's
and
right.
the knowledge of the things that are critical for my success
oh,
and destiny.
Yes.
He's
oh,
obligated
yes.
to do it.
He's
so
obligated.
Here's what he does. He will cause me to be aligned with the right person.
Yes.
Bible says now in Luke chapter number 7, there was a man who loved the Hebrew people, the Israel people. He helped them build a sanctuary. But now, all of a sudden now, he needs God to show up for him. And
oh,
guess
yeah.
who stands for him? The Israel people stood for him and said, Jesus, he's worthy for you to
he's
bless.
Worthy.
He's worthy.
Oh, yes.
See, this could not have happened if he was not aligned with the right people.
That's right.
So watch this now. There are many of you who are watching me tonight. You are missing your breakthrough because of who you are aligned with.
That's
you miss your breakthrough because
that's
of who you align with. There are people today who don't even partner with their own pastor's vision.
Wow.
Your pastor
that's sad.
Labors in the word for you.
Mm-mm.
The Bible says that you should honor the one who labors in
yes.
word and doctrine for your sake.
That's right.
But watch that. But because I see somebody on TV, I like him a little better.
Mm-hmm.
I like her a little better, so I'm going to connect with them, partner with them. I'm going to sow my seed with them, but never sow anything to the leader that God gave you to watch over your soul. You got to learn to get that. See, when you align yourself with the leader that God gave you, here's what you're doing. You align yourself with the heart of God.
Oh, yeah.
Let's go through it. Got to prove this thing out because many of y'all look at that pastor like he's crazy. But let's go to Jeremiah 3:15. I'm going to show you that when you got to, you understand that this, the man of God or the woman of God is the heart of God for your life. So Jeremiah 3, let me get it here. Jeremiah 3:15 says it like this. He says, and I will give you pastors according to my heart.
Oh, yes.
So watch God. When God gives you a pastor, he is just giving you his heart.
That's so true.
He says, and I will give you pastors according to my heart, which shall do two things, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. What is knowledge? It's the information needed.
Right.
Understanding is how to apply the information you just got.
That's right.
But watch now. But if you're just a person who just comes to church and never connect with your leader, you never get the knowledge and the understanding because you have not truly connected to the heart of God. This is so important. God wants to align you with the right people so that he can bless your life. So we said, number one, when I'm a giver, God alters the course of my life. Number two, when I'm a giver, God aligns me with the right people that can help me. But then when I'm a giver, number three, God positions me to receive answered prayer.
Yes.
I can receive answered prayer now because I'm a giver. The Bible says, Genesis chapter 15, you can look at verse 1 all the way through verse 18. The scripture is saying now that God had promised Abram in Genesis chapter 12 that he's going to bless him and bless him greatly. And he's going to have all these children coming for him. And for three whole chapters, Abram is trying to figure this thing out. Me and my wife, we've been trying and ain't nothing happening. Maybe God got a better way, a different way. And so he's saying to God, God, you said this. Now, how you going
to
do this?
Yeah, how you going to bring this to pass?
How you going
to
bring this to pass? Now, I'm going to look at it. I'm going to examine. Now, only one heir in my house is a slave.
Yeah, I'm getting old now.
His name is Eliezer. That didn't come from my mouth, so right. God now is dealing with him. No, the one that's going to come for you is coming out of your own bowels. It's coming from you. And he says to God, well, how am I going to know you're going to do this?
Right.
So he tells him, take me an offering. He says, take me a heifer, a she-goat. You know, and here's what I want you to do. I want you to take them, build me an altar, and I want you to put them on the altar, cut all of these in half.
Oh, yeah.
And then the Bible says, here's what God does. God comes down. He causes a great darkness to come over.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says, now God comes down and he's walking in the midst of these halves that have been cut.
Woo.
Blood is spilled on the altar, and God is walking in the midst of them with a burning torch. And here's what God does. He reveals to him or gives him clarity and understanding of where he's going to be.
Right.
In a sense, he got answered prayer.
Yes.
It's important for you to get this. We said, number one, when I'm a giver, God alters the course of my life. Number two, when I'm a giver, God aligns me with the right people that can help me. Number three, when I'm a giver, God positions me to receive answered prayer. Now, my giving now allows me to take a stand for the cause of Christ. I'm just not giving just to be given.
Right.
But I'm taking a stand for the cause of Christ. To take a stand means that I make a conscious choice to stand for God, denying Satan's will in the earth with my gifts, talents, and my treasure or my financial support. So I take a stand with my gifts, with my talents, with my financial support. I take a stand.
Take a stand.
So my giving to kingdom projects, my giving to kingdom works, my giving to my local church is me taking a stand against the enemy. I'm telling the devil that you will not destroy or devour another person again in life. I become the conduit by which God flows to. My money takes a stand.
Oh, yes.
I may not be able to preach the gospel like somebody else, but my money can.
My money takes a stand.
Takes a stand.
Oh, yeah.
I may not be able to sing like somebody else, but my money takes a stand.
Takes
you understand? Because what we're doing, we're building people.
Yes.
We're rescuing people. We're bringing people out of child pornography.
Oh, yeah.
We're bringing people out of slavery, out
That's
of bondage.
Right.
We're pulling them out of this.
Oh,
and
yeah.
It takes resources to get it done.
It takes resources.
So it's important for you to understand this. My giving causes me to take a stand for the cause of Christ. In other words, I'm building the house of God.
Oh,
now, the Bible tells us in 1 Chronicles chapter 29, the scripture says, now hear God now. I mean, here Moses has, not Moses, but here David has an idea. He's older. He wants to do something for God before he dies. And he's older now, and he's saying, I'm going to build God a house. The preacher comes along and said, that's a good idea. God wants you to do that.
Yes.
But then God starts to speak to him, and God tells him, you can't build my house because you got too much blood on your hands.
Mm-hmm.
But here's what I want to do. I'm going to let your son Solomon do it. Solomon is going to be the one that builds my temple for me. And so watch now. David understands now that Solomon is young. has no revelation and no understanding. He's inexperienced. So guess what David says? I got to help my son.
Right.
So when you look at 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse number 1, David says it like this. It said, furthermore, David the king said unto the congregation, Solomon, my son, whom alone God has chosen, is yet young and tender. In other words, he's inexperienced. He's never done this before. Mm-hmm. And the work is great for the palace. It's not for the man, but for the Lord God. Now I have prepared with all of my might for the house of my God, the gold for the things to be made of gold, and silver for the things of silver, and the brass for the things of brass, the iron for the things of iron, and wood for the things of wood, and onyx stones, and stones to be set, glycerin stones, and of divers colors, and all manner of precious stones, and marble stones in abundance. Moreover, because I have set my affection to the house of my God, I have of my own proper good of gold and silver, which I have given to the house of my God, over and above all that I have prepared for the holy house. And then he goes on now, and he starts to define how much he gave.
Yes.
He says, I made a conscious decision now that I'm going to help build the temple, but guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to go into my private stash. I already done gave an offer, but I'm going to my private stash now. And guess what I'm going to do with my private stash? I'm going to give more than what I gave over here I believe in the kingdom so much. That's I believe in the work of God so much. So he says, I'm going to do more than just a bare minimum. I'm going to do exceedingly abundantly above. I'm going to go beyond this because I'm going to do more for this because I believe in this.
I'm going to do an over and above
I'm going to do an over and above seed. Mm-hmm. And there are people today, you have to realize something, that an over and above seed is an amazing thing. That you are literally making a sacrifice and you are putting God in a place now where God has to do it for you on a great scale.
That's
now,
right.
Let's go look at it from the voice translation. The voice translation gives us a better understanding now. Watch now. Voice translation, 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse number 1, says it like this. Although my son Solomon was chosen by God and has the ability to build a beautiful temple, he is still young and inexperienced for such a great work. This work is not for men. It is for the eternal God. I have tried to help him as much as I can by providing gold, silver, bronze, iron, wood, and stones, the onyx, inlaid stones, adamant stones of various colors, precious stones and alabaster, he says, in abundance to use in my God's temple. Then he says, furthermore, I will give my own gold and silver treasure in addition to the materials I have provided for the construction to the temple because of my delight in the house of my God. And watch how much he gives.
Ooh.
How much David gives, the over and above what he gives, is going to shock you.
Oh, yeah.
The Bible says in verse number 4, these gifts included 110 tons of the finest gold, 260 tons of the refined silver to cover the walls of the building, more gold and more silver as needed. All of this work will be done by the skilled workers. So who then is willing to give of himself this day to the eternal one? So here's what he said. He didn't just give a little bit.
Oh, He gave tons.
He gave tons to build this. And he says, and we got skilled workers to help pull this off. And then here's what he does. He makes an appeal to the leaders that are with him.
Right.
See, that's what our impact giving is all about. This is why we encourage our leaders to go with their pastor in their giving.
We never
tell them what to give, but we say, because you're a leader, we need you to lead from the back and lead from the front and never from the back.
Right.
So we, in our impact giving, we announce the giving that we give, how much it's going to be, and everything like this. We never tell our leaders what to give, how much to give. We never tell our members how much to give.
But we
do ask our leaders to follow the leading of their pastor. And we do this because the Bible gives us this instruction. Now, look at verse number six. Verse number six said, then family leaders, the leaders of the tribes of Israel, the commanders of the thousands and of hundreds, and the managers over the king's work offered willingly. For the servants of the temple of God, they gave, watch now, this is the leaders, 190 tons and 185 tons of gold, 375 tons of silver, 675 tons of brass, 3,750 tons of iron. Anyone who owned precious stones gave them willingly to the treasury of the temple of the eternal, where they were managed by Jehiel the Gershonite. Then verse number 9 says, then all the people rejoiced because the officers had given to the eternal so willingly and wholeheartedly. And King David also rejoiced greatly.
Yes.
Look at this.
That's good.
The leaders followed suit.
They follow suit.
The leaders got together and said, this thing is important.
Oh, yeah.
That I'm not sitting back and I'm not participating. I'm not supporting. This thing is important. We need the house of God.
Oh,
so
yes.
They joined in following David. This is why it's so important for you to get revelation and for you to get understanding and to know why God wants to do this.
Now, let's go a step further into the lesson now so we can hurry up and get ready to close. I believe we got about another 5-10 minutes and we got to get out of here. But let's hurry up. Let's continue on now. We said my giving allows me to take a stand for the cause of Christ. Now, when you have passion for the things of God, it will cause you to have what I call a conviction of heart, a conviction in your heart. Number two, it'll cause you to have a change of attitude. Number three, it'll cause you to make a conscious adjustment in life. But then number four, it'll call you to have a call to action. Now, let's deal with it now. When I have a passion for the things of God, it will cause you to have, number one, a conviction in your heart. A conviction in your heart is a compassion to see souls saved.
Oh, yeah.
And I want to see souls saved.
That's
saved. What the giving is about. It's about bringing people into the kingdom, yes. Getting people taught up, getting people built up, getting people saved. You understand? That's what this is all about. Introducing them to the eternal God so that they will know that the same God who blessed somebody else, the same one who blesses them. The same one who forgave that person is the same one who forgave this person. That's what this is all about.
Oh, yeah, the same God that saved me and you will save them.
So when I have passion for the things of God, it will cause you to have a conviction in your heart.
Yes.
But it'll also cause you to have a change of attitude. A change of attitude means that I wasn't on board with this given thing before. But now I am. I can see the need for it.
Right.
It'll cause you to have a change of attitude. See, many of you have been taught wrong attitudes about giving. Your attitude about giving is people have taught it to you this way. Mm-hmm. Give so the bills of the church can be paid, and you sitting there looking like, my bills need to be paid too. Mm-hmm. They didn't teach you the principle.
Right.
They didn't teach you that it's a principle that God uses. Everything that God does, he does by way of a seed. You are here by way of a seed.
That's right.
Your mama and your daddy came together. A seed was implanted, yes. And you were born. So everything God does, he does by way of a seed. Plants are here by seed. Mm-hmm. Desks are made by way of a seed. Somebody has to have the thought of it.
Are made by the way of a seed.
It's a seed. It's everything a seed. Is based on a seed. It's the principle of God.
Yes.
So we have to teach you the right way, the real reason why God wants you to give, and the benefits that's attached to you.
Right.
But when I grew up in Pleasant Grove Missionary Baptist Church, down by Bird Clare, Hawking Den is what we called it, going to church down there, they didn't put no emphasis on no giving. They didn't put no emphasis on no giving. They just told us, come on, bring an offering, and folks just brought change. And you could hear the change hit the bucket. Blucker, blucker, that was it. If we ever received $100 offering in the giving and on Sunday morning, boy, we did a miracle. Mm-mm-mm. Never was anything that was amazing. Because nobody was taught it. Nobody was taught the real reason.
Right.
We were not taught that giving gets you out of poverty.
Oh, yes,
we
it
were
does.
Not taught that giving opens up doors for you that no man can shut. We were not taught that giving calls favor to show up, that it'll cause us to have answered prayer.
Oh,
we were
yes.
not taught that. So it's our job as pastors to teach you the real reason that God wants you to give. It is not for you to enrich the church. It is not for you to enrich the pastor. It is not for that.
That's
but it's also to bless you. It is God's legal way of blessing you. So we said, when you have passion for the things of God, it will cause you to have a conviction in your heart. It'll cause you to have a change of attitude. But number three, it'll cause you to make a conscious adjustment in your life. In other words, I make a decision to be passionate about what God is passionate about. People.
That's people. God loves people.
I never forget him sitting in the bed one night.
God loves people.
My wife is trying to sleep, and it's around 12 at night, and I'm finishing up my lesson and everything, and we just really start pastoring. Mm-hmm. And God had put in my heart to teach on love, and I didn't want to do it. The reason I didn't want to do it because I didn't have no understanding of love. And so as I'm putting my lesson together, the light switch came on, and I understood what God loved and what he was passionate about.
Oh, yes.
It was people.
It was people.
I remember doing my wife, and hey, wake up, wake up, wake up. I said, hey, God, I know what God is passionate about. I know what he loves. And she said, what, honey? I said, he loves people.
God loves people.
I didn't have that clue before.
Oh, yes.
So it made me look at love from a different perspective.
Right.
For God so loved the world
right.
that he gave. See, mm-hmm. see the principle in this? For God so loved the world, he gave.
Oh, yes, he did.
So we said it'll cause you to have a conviction in your heart, a change of attitude. It'll cause you to make a conscious adjustment in your life. But it will also cause you to have a call. It will also it'll also cause you to have a call to action. A call to action now is, I wasn't given before to support the vision, but now I will. Mm-hmm. I see the need for it. I'm going to go and do it now. It's a call to action. I see the mothers who need help. I see this individual who need help. I need that. I see that individual who needs help. Mm-hmm. The church needs to have a food pantry because we need to be able to feed people in the neighborhood.
That's right.
We need to have a back to school program because kids are getting ready to go back to school. We need to be able to give them some pencils and paper and backpacks. We can go a step further and give them some tablets, some laptops, and things like that because they're going to need it. You understand? See, we have to think outside of the box. We cannot think along the lines of just, you go to pastor riding in a Cadillac. He got my money. Listen at this. Every pastor you see who's riding good doesn't mean that he got the money from the members.
Exactly.
Don't let the devil fool you. Don't let the devil make you think that. Don't let him make you think that. Watch now. You get upset with a pastor for riding good and dressing good and having multiple cars, but you'll celebrate 50 Cent. You'll celebrate Migos. You'll celebrate all of them because after all, they got it. They got chains worth $100,000. Lord, don't let Reverend come up in there with a chain around his neck cost $2, y'all. Pay. Oh, you done took the church money. Got all that church time. If you don't stop with that foolishness. So the devil does that to us.
The devil does it. Yeah.
He makes us think that.
Right.
He takes scripture out of content and makes us look at it wrong. You understand? Like we see during Christmas time. See Jesus in the manger. Little baby Jesus in the manger. You see three wise men coming, kneeling down, and Jesus in the manger, and they presenting, each one of them presenting them a gift. And it makes you think that Jesus was an infant when they brought a gift to him.
Right.
And it makes you think that they gave him a limited offering. And that's not true at all. This is why you have to read your Bible. Matthew chapter 2 tells us different. That Jesus was at least 2 years old when the wise men found him.
Yeah.
And there were not three wise men. There were hundreds of wise men who came looking for him.
Yeah, he was at least two.
He was at least two years old. And hundreds of wise men came looking for him. And they didn't bring one gift. They brought three types of gifts. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And the Bible says that when they came with the offerings, theologians said the offerings that they brought Jesus on that day was so much that it would fill a big church.
They didn't
just bring him just this little small little thing.
Mm-mm.
So when you see that stuff on those cards, these three kings, no, it was at least 30 of them. At least 30 of them coming with hundreds of donkeys. Bringing a caravan to him to bless him.
Right.
So we have to get this out of our mind because the devil don't want you to know how important the resources is and what you can do with it and why God wants it.
Yes.
So if he can talk you out of it, now souls can't get saved. People's lives can't get transformed. People can't go to the next phase of their life because you have no revelation of what the Bible says because you don't read it.
Mm-hmm.
Let me hurry with this. Let's continue on now. Oh man, this is going to take a long period to get finished with this. Let me get with this part right here. See, when we take a stand for the cause of Christ, I can expect eight things. Your Bible, yours says seven. I had to add one. When I take a stand for the cause of Christ, I can expect eight things to take place in my life. Number one, I can expect God to recall the offering that I have sown and give me what I really desire.
Okay.
Bible tells us in Acts chapter number 10, Cornelius now has been given to the Jewish people and supporting them and helping them. And then all of a sudden now, an angel appeared to him and starts to tell him, your offering has come up before God as a memorial. And he says to him now, here's what I need you to do. When you look at verse number 4, he says, when he looked on him, he was afraid and said, what is it, Lord? And he said unto him, thy prayers and thy alms has come up as a memorial for him before God. So watch now. He's saying now, your prayers has come up as a memorial before God. When you start to look at verse number 6 says, that what you wanted, he'll tell you what to do. Or he'll tell you how to get it.
That's good.
What you've been looking for, he'll tell you how to get it.
So he'll give you a plan of action.
He'll give you the plan of action that you need.
He'll give you a plan of action.
He said, I'll give you. He's, in a sense, he's saying to him, that what you was looking for, he says, send for Peter. He's going to show you how to get it.
Oh, yeah.
He's going to show you how to get it. So I can expect God to recall the offering that I have sown and give me what I really desire. Number two, I can expect God to reciprocate in my life what I have sown into someone else's life.
That's right.
What is that? Ephesians 6 and 8 says, knowing any good, knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether he be bond or free. So you, whatever you make happen for one, God is obligated to make happen for you. See, you can't do good towards someone and God not give it back to you.
That's right.
So I can expect God to reciprocate it back in my life.
Oh, yeah.
But I can also expect God to reward me with the maximum return on the seed that I have sown. I can expect him to do that. The Bible tells us this in Matthew chapter 19. You look at verse 27 through 29. And the Bible makes a point to tell us that no man has forsaken houses of brothers, of sisters, of fathers, of mothers, of wife, of children, of lands for my name's sake. He says, and shall receive 100-fold, and shall he have inherit eternal life. And what's the 100-fold is the maximum return that you can get on the seed that you sow. Right. So I can expect God now to reward me with the maximum return.
Oh yeah.
And then number four, I can expect God to reveal his plan of action for my life, or his plan for my life. We just seen that in Genesis chapter 15,
right,
where he reveals to Abram his plan for his life.
That's right.
But then number five, I can expect God now to release a supernatural power into my life when I'm in trouble. When I'm in trouble and I don't know what to do and I'm a giver, I can expect God to release his supernatural power into my life to help me. Woo. Bible tells a story in 2 Kings chapter number 4. You look at verse 1 through 7 and you start to look at verse number 3. Here this woman had her husband has died and their creditors come and take her children.
Okay.
And she don't know what to do, but she calls on the man of God and asks the man of God for help. And the man of God is saying to her, oh, what you got? What you got? I got this is all. Go borrow vessels.
Right.
So the man of God has given her a plan. The supernatural power of God is released because she sees it after she borrowed the vessels, and she sees that God now brings her out of poverty. He brings her off of welfare and makes her an entrepreneur in a minute, just that.
Overnight.
Overnight. Because his supernatural power is released into her life.
Mm-hmm.
But then number six, I can expect God now to repay me for helping the poor. So when I help with the outreaches and I sow into this, I can expect God to repay me.
Yes.
The Bible said in Proverbs 19 and 17, he that have pity on the poor lend it unto the Lord, and that which he have given will he pay him again. So when I'm giving to the poor, God says, I'm the one now that's going to pay that back for you.
Pay it back. Oh, yeah.
And you know God owes nobody nothing.
No.
So he's going to give it to you on a press down, shaking together, running over man. So this is why you can't be the person who sits back and say, I'm not going to give. No, baby, I'm going to put my hands to the plow.
Oh,
I'm going to get them, be a part of kingdom projects. I'm going to help the poor. I'm going to feed the hungry. I'm going to do all of this because God obligates himself to bless me.
Yes, he does.
But then now. Number seven, I can expect God to reestablish me to a place of prominence.
Right.
When I'm a giver. The Bible tells us a story in Job that Job loses everything now. Job said, the thing that I feared the most have come upon me. He done lost it all. But
right.
Job says now, the thing I feared the most came upon me. And Job gave voice to his fear. It wasn't God who was testing him. It was Job who opened up the door. And the devil walked in and destroyed Job's life.
Oh, yeah.
But now all of a sudden now, Job now, something supernaturally changed in his life. It turned for him because the Bible said Job prayed for his friends. When he prayed for his friend, here's what God did. He gave him twice as much as he had. When you look at verse number 10, verse 10 says, and the Lord, Job chapter 42, verse 10 says, and the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. Also, and the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. In other words, Job was restored back to a place of prominence.
Oh, yeah.
Because of his sacrifice, because of his seed. But then number eight, I can expect God to reproduce in my life what I have sown in the life of somebody else.
That's right.
Whatever I give to somebody else, whatever I give to, gives back to me.
Gives back to me.
The Bible tells us in Genesis chapter number 1, if you look at verse number 12, and the earth brought forth grass, and herb yielding seed after its kind, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself. And God saw that it was good. It's a principle.
Oh, yeah.
It's got to come back to me. It's a kingdom principle that God obligates himself to reproduce in my life what I have sown into the life of somebody else.
That's right.
That's why I give every single day.
Oh, yes.
I don't just tithe because tithing is not giving. I'm talking to somebody today because you think tithing is giving. Tithing is not giving.
No, it's not.
Tithing is the temple tax that you owe.
That's right.
You're supposed to give 10% of your earnings. You're supposed to do that. If somebody walks up to you and gives you $50, you're supposed to tie $5 off of that.
That's right.
If you're on a job and the gross of your job is $10,000 a week, you're supposed to tie $1,000 off of that.
That's
you're
right.
supposed to do that. That ain't no if, ands, or buts. You're supposed
right.
to do that. My offering is not a tithe, and my tithing is not an offering.
Right.
The tithe is based on the trust system. God trusts you to bring the tithe.
Oh, yes.
The offering is an act of my love, my gratitude, and my appreciation to God. In a sense, I'm saying to God, I love you and I appreciate you for what you've done for me. And my seed reflects that. It's important for us to know the difference.
Right.
And there are people today, you have not really given God an offering. You just give your tithe.
Wow.
It's tithes and offering.
That's right.
Tithes and offering.
Yes.
The and is a conjunction word.
Ooh.
which means I can't do what's on the right side of the word and without first doing what's on the left side. Tithes and offerings.
Yes.
It's so crucial for us to understand that. It's important now. And that's our word for you tonight. If you got questions tonight, we want you to type your question. We want to answer them. We got a few moments tonight, but I want to pray for you. But while you're doing this, I want you to get your seed in the ground tonight. Don't let the devil stop you from giving. You're not looking at pastors who don't sow and who don't give. We give every single day. I'm a giver every single day.
Right.
The members of my church, I may send a seed to them.
That's
they
right.
don't know if a seed is coming to them. Pastor does it based on how God is leading him to do it.
Exactly.
So I put a seed in the hands of my members. There are other people I sow seed to. There are times where I sow seed to this person. I don't even know them. But God has put it in my heart to do that. I make it a point to sow to my man of God every week. I don't miss. Because I understand that giving is the key that opens up the doors that leads to my prosperity.
Oh,
so
yes.
I'm giving every single time because it's a spiritual principle that God has set up in the earth by way he could bless me. And so I make it a point to do it. I don't do it haphazardly. I don't do it because I see that person has a need. I do it because God told me to do
That's
it.
That's right.
Talking to somebody today. You better grab this principle. You better grab this principle. You must become a giver. Giving gets you out of the situation that you're in.
Oh, yes.
So what you make happen for one, God is obligated to make happen for you. So when you help us bring our kingdom projects to pass, God brings them to pass in your life.
Oh yeah.
The Bible says while Solomon was building God's house, he was building his own. I need you to see this. Here he is. He's got all of this tons of money that people have brought to help him build God's house. And while he was building God's house, he was building his own. So when I'm sowing and supporting, I'm helping to build my own house.
That's right.
We've been sowing seed because our dream now is next year to have our house built from the ground up.
That's right.
We done walked it out, mapped it out, talked about it, prayed about it, believing God for it every single day, making faith confession, got our seed in the ground. We know that it's going to take place.
Oh, yes.
Built from the ground up. And it must be bigger than the house that we're in
That's
now.
Right.
Got to be bigger. I'm talking to somebody today. I'm not putting no more limitations on God. God is obligated to do it. He's obligated to help me.
Yes.
I don't have to try to figure it out. I just know he's going to work it out.
Yes,
he's
going to
work it out for me.
Oh,
right
yes.
now, the place we're in right now is almost 3,800 square feet. Now, we're about to move into something that's well over 4,000. We putting it out there in the atmosphere.
Oh, yeah.
We don't care what the haters say, what the naysayers say. We don't care what nobody say. We believe God. We
that's
have
right.
sown seed for many years.
Many
we have
years.
Rescued many people.
Many
we walk
people.
With God for many years.
Oh,
we've
yes.
been faithful. The Bible said, if you're
faithful
over a few things, I'll make you ruler over much.
That's right.
So we're repositioning ourselves to be rulers over much. I'm talking
yes.
to somebody today.
Oh, yes.
You better take your dream and dust it off.
Woo,
and say, you know what? Because I'm a giver now.
Tonight.
I'm about to step out of my comfort zone
and
step over into something that is bigger than something, bigger than what I can comprehend.
Oh,
the
yes.
Bible says it like this. Your eyes have not seen, nor have your ear heard, and neither have it entered into the heart of man.
Woo.
The things that God has prepared for them that love him, he has something prepared for you that's going to blow your mind. You ought to type tonight, God's got to blow your mind, blessing, wait on me. He's got to blow your mind, blessing, wait on me tonight.
Right.
Boy, if I was up in Pleasant Grove, if I was up in our church, I'd be ready to go in right there. He's got something good
That's
for you
good.
Right now. I'm talking to you today. Don't let your seed be dormant, but plant your seed and watch God do some amazing things for you.
Blow your mind.
This is the God that we
oh
have. He's ready to give you a blow your mind blessing.
Ooh,
I'm telling
good.
You, he's
that's
ready
good.
To give you a blow your mind blessing. Oh, my God.
My God.
Let me get myself together so I get off this thing and go watch NCIS.
I think Kim over there hollering hallelujah. I'm all
rich,
Kim.
Listen, you got to get ready.
Blow
your mind blessing. I'm telling you, he ready. I'm telling you, get ready. For some
yes,
of y'all,
yes,
y'all need
yes.
to get ready for
hallelujah.
Real. He's about to release the
my
blow
God.
Your mind blessing. Let's get off this thing right now. Listen, we are ready to pray for you after this service is over.
Oh, yes, we are.
We'll be available for 10 minutes after this service.
Yes.
So here's the number, 323-238-9915. Again, 323-238-9915.
Mm-hmm.
We're ready to pray for you tonight for whatever your challenge or issue is.
Mm-hmm.
But I need you to get your seed in the ground. Go to our website at kingdomlifefaithcenter.org. Click on the online giving button there and get your seed in the ground tonight. If you want to give by Cash App to our church, it's the $ KLFC Church. Again, KLFC Church.
Yes.
Get it in the ground tonight. We always encourage our members not to forget their pastors
That's
in their
right.
giving. This is how we live through the free will offerings of our members. So listen,
sow into our life as well and watch God bless your life. Oh, yeah. You can do that through the Cash App if you want. To me, it's the $ Pastor C. Perryman. Again, the $ Pastor C. Perryman.
Yes.
For my wife, it's the $ Pastor Sophia. Hey, if you're the one that likes to sow through Zelle, hey, Zelle is good. It's Pastor Perryman. No, yeah, it's my email address, overseerperryman@gmail.com.
Yes.
For Zelle, you can do that. It's overseerperryman@gmail.com. Mm-hmm. If you want to do it through Venmo, is at Pastor Perryman. Get it in the ground today. Don't let the devil stop you from giving. If you just want to sow online, go to our website, kingdomlifefaithcenter.org.
That's right.
Click on the online giving button there. You can sow right there. Your tithe, your offerings, you can sow toward our compensation.
Yes.
It is right there. You can do it, all right? Listen, let me pray for you and let me dismiss you tonight. Honey, you got anything you want to add before we go?
Oh, my God. I'm still on. God got to blow your mind blessing. Oh, my God.
Yeah, he got to blow your mind blessing waiting on you.
Blow my mind, God. I'm waiting.
Listen, I need y'all to patronize my wife. She got on one of her shirts.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, and listen, thank y'all to those
thank
of
you,
who bought stuff from her.
I
appreciate
as well.
Y'all so much. But
oh,
listen,
yes,
I need y'all to tell other people about her product.
Yes.
Get her product, all right? But listen. Go to our website, get your seed in the ground. Don't
That's
let the
right.
devil stop you from giving. Listen, if you're the person that don't like to use technology, but you want to mail your seed, listen, that information is going to be on the screen
you.
Here in just
yes.
a moment. I believe that is P.O. Box
3231.
P.O. Box 3231.
Mm-hmm.
What else is it? P.O. Box 3231.
Quartz Hill.
Quartz Hill, California. Q-U-A-R-T-Z.
Right.
Hill, H-I-L-L, California.
Mm-hmm.
And the zip code is...
93586.
Yeah, 93586. Again, it's P.O. Box 3231. P.O. Box 3231.
Mm-hmm.
Quartz Hill, California. 93586. Get your seed in the ground tonight. If you're the one that mails it, mails it. Mail it, all right?
Yeah.
Make sure you when you put on the envelope, you put Kingdom Life Faith Center.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can put my name, Pastor Curtis Perryman. If you don't do
right.
that, they'll send the mail back to you, all right?
Yeah,
we don't want them to send it back to you, all right? So listen, we're getting ready to go.
Yes.
We're ready to pray for you after this service is over with. But listen, we want you to know that we love you. We appreciate
yes,
you.
We do.
Thank
we
you to everybody who's on the conference call,
yes.
everybody on our Kingdom Life Faith Center page, everybody on Instagram, and everybody on Facebook Live
That's
on
right.
my page, Overseer Perryman. I love y'all. I appreciate y'all so very much. Oh, man, listen, if you don't have a church home and you want to make Kingdom Life Faith Center your church home,
That's
you
right.
can do that. Doesn't matter what state you live in.
Does
doesn't matter what country you live in. Doesn't matter if you're in Arizona, if you're in New York, if you're in Tennessee, if you're in Texas, if you're in Greenwood. Doesn't matter where you are. If you're in another country, you can be a part of Kingdom Life Faith Center.
You can be a cyber member.
You can be a cyber member. The same grace and same blessing that's on us will be on you.
Yes.
And listen to this. We will treat you like a real member.
That's right.
We'll
that's
treat
right.
you like
yes,
a real
we
member.
Will. Yes,
we don't
we
have
will.
To meet you in person for you to be a member of our church.
That's right.
But listen, we promise to love on you. We promise to care for you.
Yes.
We promise to even call you from time to time.
Oh, yes.
We promise to do that
that's
for
right.
you. All right? And listen, and if you're one of the ones who says, you know what, Pastor, if there's a funeral and I live in New York, will you be willing to come do the funeral? Hey, we will do the best that we can
That's
to
right.
provide some services for you.
Yes.
All right? So you are never going to be without. You'll never be alone. You can always be with us.
Oh,
all
yeah.
right? Hey, we just had some members join our church recently.
That's
and some of them we haven't seen ever.
We haven't met them yet.
But they've
met
except
us online.
For one, but except for one. You know, I know Miss Sheila Roby from when we were
oh,
in school.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
But I hadn't seen her since 1987.
I know.
But she's still a part
that's
of this
so
ministry.
True.
Even though she is a Saints fan. Crystal, we got to do something about this. We 49er
oh,
fans. We got to do something about this.
Crystal.
But listen, you can be a member of our church. It doesn't matter.
That's
same
right.
grace that's on us.
It's
I'll be
on you.
On you. I'm
right.
telling you.
Oh, yeah.
Listen, and for those of you who heard about us through somebody else, what they tell you about us is real.
Oh, yeah.
You understand?
We
I'm
love
straightforward,
our members.
Straightforward, Pastor.
Oh,
we
yes.
real. We look after our members. We
That's
care
right.
for our members.
That's
we there
right.
for our members.
Oh,
we'll
yeah.
move heaven and earth for our members.
Oh,
this
yes,
is
we will.
Real. Okay,
oh,
this ain't no
yes.
fakeness. This is really
this
real
is
on
real.
This side.
Oh, yeah.
So
and we do
y'all,
weddings, too.
And we do weddings and stuff like that, too. And so listen, y'all come on. This is a pastor who loves his wife. I ain't
That's
sleeping
right.
with the members of the church.
That's right.
So I'm going to get down.
Not at all.
I got enough over here on this one. All right. So listen, we got to go. But we love y'all. We appreciate y'all so very much. And thank y'all so much for being on. We'll see y'all again tomorrow morning at 8:15 a.m. Pacific Standard Time on
right.
In the Backyard with Pastor Perryman.
In the Backyard,
all right?
8:15.
Love y'all. We'll see y'all again
love
tomorrow.
You guys.
Be blessed in Jesus' name. Love y'all.